He works at the University of California, Berkeley, and he's got some fascinating stories, but he's going to tell us, I think he's going to be imaging the lunar eclipse later tonight. We've also got Duncan Cock. Now, Bob did a fantastic interview with him, and you've got to read that. Now, Duncan Cock is a documentary filmmaker and slew friend. If you've seen a documentary on the moon on TV, chances are Duncan had something to do with it. His films are absolutely wonderful. So, great interview there, talking about the moon landings, which is a passion of both Bob and of Duncan. We've also got Michael Narlock coming on. Now, Michael is our new SLU educator, and he's also going to run, he's going to introduce actually this new program that we've got called SLU Classroom. And he's the head of astronomy at Cranbrook, at the Cranbrook Institute of Science. But he's going to introduce this program, and then I'm going to hand over to him for 15 or 20 minutes, and he's actually going to take a first classroom. So I'm really looking forward to that, because I always learn something new when I listen to Michael. So that's going to be terrific to hear about that new program. We are hopefully going to be talking to Matt Francis, who Bob Berman is with. So Matt Francis is the director of the Prescott Observatory in Arizona. That's where this lovely, lovely live image is coming from. And we can already see, we'll get Bob on it in a minute, we're already seeing this chunk of the moon taken out. The eclipse is fully underway. We've also got Jeff Fox coming on. He's going to be a new presenter, a new host and producer for SLU. So we're really looking forward to introducing him nearer the end of our four-hour coverage, would you believe? But back to Bob. Bob, conditions still looking great. Look at this fantastic image coming from the observatory that you're currently in.
Yes, exactly. And people are surprised to see that the edge of the moon now, it looks like it's the umbral or dark eclipse is beginning. We actually have a few seconds more. And the reason it looks dark on the left side is that it's not an abrupt transition. We're looking at a place on the moon where 98% of the sunlight is blocked, and then as you look further to the left, 99 and 99.5 and 99.9. So it's a gradation. You get to the part of the moon where no sunlight is hitting it at all. And that's what's starting now in a matter of seconds. And I should mention that for the first, at least the first half hour, it will look like a black shadow is enveloping the moon. And the fact that you and I both said that the Earth's shadow usually shows a coppery red color, people will think, well, we were mistaken, we're wrong. But thanks to the eye, and in this case the camera and this all this marvelous equipment, adjusting to the brightness of the sunlit part, the dark part will look black at first, and only as the eclipse is near the end of the partial phase, and then certainly when it's fully eclipsed, then we'll see the true color.
Yeah, and Matt's having to do an awful lot of work there. I know he's got a video feed that we're going to show later as well, but these images are absolutely stunning. So thank you, Matt. I know he's going to be working furiously in the background. Bob, just tell people before we move on to the next segment of the show, I'm going to reintroduce the whole show, introduce our next guest, Professor Timothy Ferris. Tell viewers who are watching this in their own backyard how best they can watch a four-hour eclipse. I mean, I always get a kind of sunbed chair and basically just sit back, relax, get a blanket over me and, you know, usually a hot thermos next to me. What else would you recommend for people?
Well, definitely. And now the partial phase has begun. The shadow of Earth has now started. So people who are in their backyards or looking out their windows, either using binoculars or the naked eye, that's the best. You really don't want a telescope for this unless you've got the exact best kind of equipment. Unfortunately, there's a big chunk of the United States that's under clouds right now, and those who are suffering from clouds, just stick with us here because we'll bring it to you live. So the eclipse is now underway. We are seeing the black shadow of the Earth. It's very interesting that the shadow's radius, you can see the curvature of it, is not the same as the moon's radius. And that's because Earth starts out being four times the size of the moon, and our shadow tapers like a chopstick to get smaller and smaller. And even at the moon's distance of a quarter of a million miles, the shadow is still twice as large as the moon. So we're seeing different radii or curvatures of shadows and curvings. You see, the edge of the moon has one type of curvature, greater curvature, and the shadow that it's going into has a different curvature. So it's quite a kind of wonderland of different geometries here.
Thank you, Bob. We will be coming back to Bob Berman after our next guest. We're kind of restarting the show. We started a little bit earlier. We started 20 minutes early because we knew a lot of people were wanting a bit of an explanation beforehand. But I'm going to reintroduce our show now. Hello, I'm Paul Cox. This is SLU, the Community Observatory. We operate online robotic observatories. Our flagship observatory is in the Canary Islands, and that is perfectly timed for people in North and South America because it means basically you can control the telescopes from the comfort of your own home but not have to stay up all night, not like everybody's done tonight. Everybody tonight has either got up incredibly early or stayed up incredibly late to watch this fabulous lunar eclipse, and this is a live image that we're seeing at the moment on our screens. Now, our flagship observatory, it's at this world-class observatory site in the Canary Islands, and our partners there have organized a fantastic image, which is going to be showing the moon setting. And where our observatory is a large volcano, and that volcano is going to cast a shadow that points directly down to the moon. So we're going to keep an eye on that and share that into our broadcast during the show. Now, we are celebrating our 10th year of operation this year, and we've got some big plans to market. Not least, we are running a special promotion tonight. And if you fancy controlling robotic telescopes in a worldwide community of other amateur astronomers who just love this stuff, right, we will also give you a pair of free binoculars. These are large binoculars, 12 by 70s. We're going to tell you all about them a little bit later when Bob Berman comes back on. But for now, I would like to welcome our wonderful guest. Thank you very much for coming on, Professor Timothy Ferris. Now, Timothy Ferris is a prize-winning author, and one of his books, I believe, was Pulitzer Prize nominated. Timothy, can you hear us?
I can hear you, Paul.
Thank you so much for joining us. Now, you are in Sonoma County. For those of us who are not in the United States, whereabouts is that?
I'm about 60 miles north of San Francisco at Rocky Hill Observatory, built here on Sonoma Mountain some 20 years ago.
And what's the weather like for you? Are you going to get to see the eclipse live in your own backyard observatory, or are you watching the images with the rest of us?
No, I'm looking at the actual moon. It's a bit soupy here, and there's some high clouds going parallel across the sky like great white brush strokes. But the and there's also quite a large halo, well, it's always the same size halo, ice crystal halo around the moon. But there's pretty good view even through all of that. I can see the eclipse starting to take a bite out of the forward or eastern side of the moon.
I sometimes feel see either the moon or the sun behind it, that actually it adds a little bit of depth sometimes to it. Is that what you've got, or is it a bit soupier than that?
No, it's not bad at all, and we had an experience of that at moonrise here 3 hours ago at 8 o'clock Pacific time, when the moon rose in the clouds looking rather coppery and odd, even though it was before the eclipse had really begun. So it, find that the weather can sometimes add a bit to stargazing.
So there's going to be a lot of people tonight who are weathered out in the United States. We've lost two of the image feeds that we were hoping to have, and I believe a lot of the country is covered in clouds. So you're one of the few and far between who have got some clear skies. We've got these fabulous skies. I don't know if you can see our images at the moment, can you? This is coming from the Prescott Observatory in Arizona. And is that exactly what you're seeing?
At the moment, I'm up in the open on the observatory deck itself, and the monitor here is displaying the results of a time-lapse sequence of photos that I'm taking through a 750-millimeter lens. And in some ways, the photos show the eclipse even more clearly than the naked eye view, because that is, of course, a bit of a telescope on there. So, no, I'm unable to see your feed from on these monitors, but I do have multiple views of the eclipse, and I can see it just over the trees here in the southeast, now getting to be kind of a pronounced bite out of the moon. And,
which is exactly what we're seeing. We are seeing this very obvious arc of just blackness, really, a chunk being taken out of the moon. Now, you must have viewed quite a few lunar eclipses and solar eclipses, but this, I don't think you've had in the United States, have you, a lunar eclipse for quite a time?
It's been a while. I think the first time I photographed one of these was at the age of 16, which is a very long time ago, Florida. Change in color of the moon as the eclipse progresses. You never quite know what that what it's going to look like. It's a result of the particulate matter in the Earth's atmosphere. And at this point, I should say, looking at the moon now, that one can see particularly well the sort of ragged edge that the Earth's atmosphere causes in its shadow. It's not a knife edge such as you see in the solar eclipse when the moon passes in front of the sun. You could, you know, if you were dropped here from somewhere far across the galaxy, you could quickly conclude that you were seeing the edge of a planet with an atmosphere.
So, this is not the only eclipse that I think the United States and North America is going to have, is it, this year? Aren't there a number? I think there are four eclipses this year.
We're in one of the cycles where there'll be several, so if you're weathered out this time, keep an eye out for the next one.
Now, one of the questions that we've had use that hashtag. Our producer will be monitoring that all night long for the 4 hours, and they'll feed through questions. And one of those questions is why doesn't a lunar eclipse occur every month at full moon?
Well, the eclipse occurs when the moon in its orbit happens through the Earth's shadow. And if the plane of the moon's orbit were lined up properly, you would have an eclipse every month, every lunar month. But because the orbit is inclined, like a pair of dish plates, and the top one not set in quite square on the bottom one, you get only two points in the orbit where they intersect, what are called the nodes. And to have an eclipse, that node has to lie right where the Earth's shadow is. So they're rather rarer, but because they are cyclical, it's been possible to predict them for a long time. And you may recall that Christopher Columbus fooled some Native Americans into
that's right.
coming up with provisions for his starving crew by warning them that he would cause the moon to be eaten up that night, because his table showed that there would be a lunar eclipse. And it did the job. This bit of deception worked, and the crew survived.
Yes, Bob Berman here. Yes.
This is SLU, the online observatory. We are broadcasting tonight live for the full 4 hours, the total lunar eclipse, which is visible over North and South America tonight. Now, if you have made this show, it means that you've stayed up incredibly late or got up incredibly early. I'm broadcasting from England, and it's 7:10 in the morning here. We have a feed coming in from the Canary Islands, which is going to be absolutely fabulous. This is from the SLU Robotic Observatory in the Canary Islands. This is where our telescopes are based, and our producer is going to pull this in. And this is a telescope specifically set up right on top of this volcano, and you can see there's ice and snow in the image. It'll come up in a second. And we are going to be watching the moon set there as the eclipse takes place, but we're going to see this fabulous shadow, this triangular shadow cast by the volcano off towards the horizon just as the moon is setting. And there you can see this image. So what we're seeing here, the very bright object is the moon. You can see the clouds below. because SLU's observatory is at this world-class observatory site. It's 8,000 feet at altitude up on top of this volcano, where the air is incredibly still. We're usually above the clouds, so the astronomical seeing is absolutely perfect. Now, you can control those telescopes, including the SLU half-meter telescope. That's a telescope with a mirror 20 inches in diameter. Now, that gives us some fabulous images of nebulae and galaxies, all in full color, because SLU does all that hard work for you. We've actually got a patent for that that we might tell you about a bit later. But anyway, you can, if you join up within the next day, we are going to give you a free pair of binoculars. And I'll tell you, these are not a cheap pair of binoculars, because it's pointless buying cheap binoculars. This is a professional pair of 12 by 70 binoculars. They're really pretty big. And we're going to tell you a lot more about those a little bit later on in the show. But back to our esteemed guest, Professor Timothy Ferris. Professor Ferris, we were looking at Mars earlier on. We did another live show a little bit earlier on. And with Rob Manning, we from the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, we were talking about the prospect of finding life elsewhere in our solar system. Now, I believe you've written about life beyond Earth, haven't you? So what's your kind of current thoughts on that subject at the moment?
Well, I've always felt that it's likely that that life is commonplace throughout the universe. And of course, that's just an opinion. The question is, what sort of evidence can one find? And we're a lot closer to having the tools necessary to look for life in a variety of extraterrestrial environments than we were even a decade or two ago. The reason that that I say that you know, I'm inclined to think that there's lots of life out there is simply that if you look at the history of the Earth, life got started here pretty early on, and the Earth doesn't show any obvious signs of being highly unusual. And there was no sort of event that seems unusual in the history of the world that might have caused this. And when you look at the way life functions, it operates the same way everything else in the universe functions. So it seems to be a natural process that arises, I would think, anywhere it can. But again, when we start to get a telescope in space that can obtain spectra from extra solar planets, we'll have some evidence to see whether these optimistic statements have any validity or not.
They are optimistic, and I know a lot of us are kind of willing us to find, make these discoveries. Now, we have had another question, actually, which is kind of related to one of the questions I wanted to ask you before we let you go, because I know you're wanting to photograph the total phases of this lunar eclipse. And I was doing a little bit of revision on our guest tonight, and I saw that you were a one-time editor of Rolling Stone magazine. Now, tell me how an editor of Rolling Stone magazine lands up producing the golden record that's now traveling beyond our solar system on the Voyager spacecraft. How on earth did you get involved with that? And could you explain to our viewers exactly what this golden record is?
Sure. There are two Voyager spacecraft, the first of which just officially exited the solar system quite recently, just a matter of months ago. Well, I guess if you go back to the announcement a little over a year ago, they will. The velocity they achieved when they went past the planet Jupiter and got a momentum boost from the giant planet flings them out of the solar system, and they'll wander among the stars forever. When this mission was being planned, Carl Sagan and his colleague Frank Drake argued for putting a record on the spacecraft. It turns out that the grooves in a metal record last a very long time, a billion to 2 billion years or more in space. So that if any civilization should ever come across the spacecraft long from now, there would be a kind of audio and visual scrapbook of who we were as a planet back in the back in 1977 when the spacecraft were launched. I knew Carl quite well, and when they were in the early stages of planning, he asked if I wanted to be involved in the project, and that's how I came to produced this recording, which has 90 minutes of music on it and a bunch of photographs and natural sounds of Earth.
There was some resistance, wasn't there, at the time, you know, that people worried that, you know, we were basically giving people the map to find Earth to whoever may find this thing?
It is. There is, in fact, a pulsar map on the jacket, the aluminum case.
We are actually looking at an image of it at the moment, and it's the series of lines down in the left-hand corner for viewers.
Yeah, it does allow you to pinpoint Earth, and there was a plaque on a prior space probe that also left the solar system, although it's moving more slowly, so it's actually now behind Voyager 1. And those maps do make it possible to locate us. When Carl was asked about this, he used to point out that our radio broadcasts have made the planet conspicuous for about a century now. They travel out through space much faster. So I suppose you could say the same thing of a note in a bottle, but I think even if there are a great many civilizations of intelligent life in the Milky Way galaxy, it would still be many, many eons before the odds would favor someone coming up with a spacecraft, whether we'll even still exist then, or who or what we might be is a difficult question.
Now, while we go back to some live images of the Moon, you mentioned there that the Voyager spacecraft had left the solar system. Now, that was quite a monumental point in time, wasn't it? This was last year or the year before?
Well, the announcement was, late last year, and the announcement was that the data indicated that the spacecraft had, in fact, left the solar system the previous year. For these purposes, the boundary of the solar system was defined by the point at which the spacecraft passed through the rather thin bubble that surrounds the sun. It's created by particles streaming out from the sun. And they eventually slow down and stall against the thin interstellar medium. When you poke through that bubble, according to the NASA standards, you have left the solar system.
And that's what happened last year. So it must be an amazing feeling that something you had a hand in producing is the first object to exit our particular neighborhood of our galaxy.
It is quite remarkable. I mean, once you get out there, the velocity of the spacecraft really counts for next to nothing. It's the spacecraft just drifts like that, as the sun does in its orbit around the center of the galaxy. And other stars do the same, so that people ask sometimes, well, you know, will it ever pass near another star? And then it will. It'll pass near various stars, but only in the sense that if you're in a lifeboat and you see an ocean liner off on the horizon, it's, you know, you're passing near it or it's passing near you, but it's, yeah, everything's in motion out there. I think it speaks well for people that we put a little note like this on the spacecraft. It says that there's more to us than the science and technology that created the spacecraft itself.
How can people find out, Professor Ferris, what's on the record? Is that available somewhere so they can hear what was chosen?
Yes, there are various websites. If you look under Golden Record or Voyager Record, that lists the contents, and there's also a book called Murmurs of Earth that the folks who worked on the project put together to have an accurate record of what the contents are.
Now, we are going to come back to Professor Ferris for a live eyewitness report on what he can see from California at the moment, but we're going to nip back to our special image from the Canary Islands at the moment. Now, this is a fascinating image. This is from the Canary Islands. The Canary Islands are a volcanic chain of islands in exactly the same way that Hawaii is. They're very tall. They're in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. Well, not in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, but they're set in the Atlantic Ocean, which means that you have this very stable airflow that comes over these very, very high volcanoes. And there's no better place on Earth to put telescopes, because it means you're above all of the turbulent air below, you're above the clouds most of the time, and this image that we're seeing now is been made available to us by our partners at the site. It's the Institute of Astrophysics in the Canary Islands. Now, this is well above the actual observatory. This is actually on what's called Pico del Teide. And this is just one cinder cone. And what we're seeing here, I know the image is a little bit at an angle. I kind of imagine behind all of this, there's a photographer clinging on for dear life on the side of the volcano. But what we're seeing there is the Pico del Teide is the kind of hill that we see running up on the right. We can see it's high altitude, it's covered in ice. If we look further down to the left, that's actually the caldera. The dark area that you see there is the caldera of the volcano, the main volcano. And we're seeing a little bit of shade and a little bit of light coming in there. Then we can see behind it the clouds and the horizon. We can even see the curvature of the Earth because the observatory is so high up. Don't forget, this is where the SLU telescopes are, and anybody can control the SLU telescopes. Just join SLU, and you get to point those telescopes wherever you like to get full color images. We're going to show you some later, but there we can see the moon. Now, the moon is setting currently in the Canary Islands. It's just off the west coast of Africa, and what we're going to be keeping an eye on is the volcano, this pointed cone volcano, is going to be casting a shadow as the sun rises in the east. It's going to cast its shadow down to the west where the moon is setting. That's going to be an absolutely spectacular image that we are going to keep an eye on, and we'll make sure that we show you that. Professor Ferris, how are conditions there? Are the clouds getting any worse, any better?
Slightly better, I would say. Almost half of the lunar disk is now covered, certainly more than a third. I just noticed through binoculars that the bright star Spica, Alpha Virgo, is quite close to the moon, just about two diameters of the moon to the south, which was not previously visible because the moon was so bright, particularly in this thin gruel of clouds. But that star is now visible. The reason, of course, is that the moon, as the eclipse proceeds, becomes dimmer and dimmer. And so across the sky, stars that were not visible in the bright light of the full moon are now coming out.
And what we're seeing now in our live images is exactly what you're seeing from your... I don't know, I guess about a third of the moon has gone just jet black. Now, I'd like to invite in... Bob Berman, SLU's astronomer. Bob, have you got any questions for Professor Ferris?
The questions? No, I would just say that I'm a longtime admirer, and Timothy Ferris is certainly one of the great astronomy writers of the last century.
Mutual Admiration Society, let's start it here. Professor Ferris, thank you very much for joining us tonight. I know that you're running off because you want to capture the total phases of the eclipse tonight. So thank you very much for joining us. And we must have you back at SLU to talk about some of your other work. So thank you very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure. Enjoy the eclipse.
Well, enjoy the rest of it yourself as well. I hope the clouds stay away.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. This is SLU, the Community Observatory. I am Paul Cox. We are showing you live images for the full 4 hours. It's SLU members, though.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.